Hi everyone, I'm Alex Neitzat and I'm going to talk about optimal mappings of geometric data with applications in 2D and 3D. Basically, the research topic is how to construct a good and optimal geometric mapping with respect to a given quality measure. More formally, the aim is to minimize some energy E that measures how close is the map F to be optimal, under the given constraint that F belongs to a certain set of maps. For example, continuous maps to preserve topology between source and target objects, or mapping onto specific domains. It could be a map from a surface to the plane or to another surface. It could be a map between volumetric domains. Also, often there are additional constraints to map certain points called anchors to a given positions, or to preserve the order of those points. To illustrate the problem and give some motivation, consider shape modifications in which we compute optimal mapping to get the desirable deformations. For example, user want to animate shape by moving positions of control points and computing optimal mapping that satisfies those constraints. And the same application in three dimensions for animating three-dimensional shapes. Also, shape deformations can be used to model how a volumetric object made of elastic material like a rubber, how it behaves under applied forces. Another widely used application is a texture mapping, also called UV mapping, used, for example, for realistic renderings of models. Here, optimal mapping is the image wrapping around a three-dimensional object with low visual distortions. And the constraints are to align landmark points. Some additional applications in computer vision, such as a shape matching problem that can be formulated as an optimal mapping that find a correspondence between points with similar geometric configurations, shape analysis applications by mapping optimal objects into a common canonical domains, and by measuring induced geometrical distortions, we can compute shape descriptors and use them for change detection and classification tasks, like here in classification of brain segments. Additional applications in computer graphics are parameterization of surfaces and volumes, generation of meshes with nearly regular polygons and polyhedrons, modeling of three-dimensional objects and materials, like this bone-like material used in three-dimensional printing, and more. So the optimal mapping is a very general problem and also very practical. We address it in this study with the following major goals. The first of all, we are going to provide a convenient formulation of the problem that is general and practical. That, of course, includes a proper definition of the optimality. We introduce new approaches to optimal mappings for scenarios in which a previously available method fails. For example, one of the main challenges is how to build an algorithm that is both fast and robust to pure initial conditions. And I'll show how to integrate our algorithms with existing methods for new applications and for a more efficient solution of a classical application. Those problems are addressed in the following sections. If there will be time at the end, I'll talk on the technical side of the implementation and about future work. In the first chapter, we deal with optimal mappings on triangle and tetrahedral meshes that minimize fundamental distortions. More precisely, mapping of a mesh is a collection of affine transformations of each triangle and tetrahedron that coincide on common faces. And this is a linear finite element approach. We show how to induce desirable transformations of simplices. We introduce new efficient optimization methods and show how to use them in different applications. And here are high quality mapping of meshes are inversion-free minimizers of such measures as angle, lengths, area distortions, and etc. I'll define formally and explain why we need the inversion-free property. And now let's see some basic examples of distortion optimizations on triangle meshes in which we prescribe a position of anchor points. and another example of distortion optimization on a tetrahedral mesh. Of course, volumetric deformations are defined on all points inside the object, and to illustrate it, we show cross sections of tetrahedral meshes. So distortion optimization problem has a long history in geometry processing. Solving it is essential in many related applications that I have mentioned before. And just to highlight, the most common classical applications are point-to-point shape deformations, surface parameterization, which is widely employed in computer graphics for texture mapping. Also, neural methods, distortion optimization techniques are used for shape matching application between surfaces. And there are many applications of three-dimensional distortion optimization for computing volumetric mappings, for example, in physical simulations of elastic materials, and etc. Now let's consider a general formulation of the problem. In general, we are solving a problem of minimizing geometric energy E that measures how much map F deviates from a given class of deformations, for example, from a class of rigid transformations. F is a piecewise affine mapping, so it can be expressed by target vertex coordinates x, and this leads to the optimization problem over vectors of target coordinates in 2D or 3D. And energy is defined in a finite element manner, that is, on triangles meshes. It's a weighted sum of distortions of triangles. Similarly, on a tetrahedral mesh, it's a weighted sum of tetrahedral distortions. That is, the energy E is a total distortion that F components induce by mapping source elements to target elements. Our task is to obtain as low as possible sum of distortions of those elements and to prevent flips. That is, we want to keep the given order of vertices. And this is the inversion-free property. It's necessary for obtaining a one-to-one mapping. I'll discuss it later in more details. The energy is defined as a volume-weighted sum of distortion D over linear components of the map that are the map Jacobians, defined on simplices. Here, D is a geometric measure that estimates a local shape distortion defined per simplex. And we compute a target vertex position X that induces minimal energy E under the following constraints. The first one is the inversion-free constraint expressed by the determinant sign. And the second one is a given constraints of the target vertex positions. And now let's define a measure D of a local distortion. We assume that D is a rotation invariant measure that estimates a local deformation of Euclidean lengths induced by linear components of F. Those measures can be expressed as a function of signed singular values of Jacobians. So if this is assigned SVD, then we assume, without loss of generality, that only the first singular value can be negative. And then according to this assumption, D is a function of the singular values, and the sign of the determinant is equal to the sign of the first singular value, sigma 1. And therefore, F will be inversion free if and only if sigma 1 is positive. Here is a short overview of the most common distortion optimization methods. Most methods are iterative solvers that start with some inversion-free initialization and modify target coordinates along energy descent direction D, computed via the following sparse linear system, where H is an approximate Hessian of E. There are many methods for constructing H. Those methods are typically divided into the first-order solvers, in which H is a function of first-order energy derivatives, and into the second-order solvers, in which, of course, H is a function of both the first and second-order partial derivatives of E, computed with respect to X. At the end of each iteration, line search methods are used to find sufficient reduce in energy E along the obtained search direction D. However, most of distortion energies are highly non-convex and need to be approximated by more simple energies, which is usually chosen to be quadratic convex functions derived from a second order expansion of E in the vicinity of the point xi. Here xi are the vertex coordinates obtained at the previous iteration. And if H is a positive semi-definite approximation of the original Hessian and D is a direction toward a local minimum of E proxy, then moving not too far along D will also reduce the original energy E. And in such a way, we update coordinates for next iteration and repeat the process until convergence. And this is how most of distortion solvers operate. For example, consider a parameterization of a Hilbert space fitting curve. It's often used as some kind of benchmark to test distortion solvers because it is disk topology and developable surface, and we know that its global minima is just to take it and unfold it to the plane. Here are results of running a projective Newton solver in which Hessian is approximated by projecting it into PSD cone. And it results in better progress per iteration compared with first order methods. But projective Newton iteration have a higher computational cost. So first order solvers have other benefits too. Our task is to propose algorithm for improving existing first and second order methods in cases where those methods fails. And to do it, let's analyze drawbacks of optimal mapping with existing solver. First of all, the vast majority of first and second order solvers have to be started with inversion-free initializations that are possible to compute only in certain scenarios. For example, in parameterization, disk topology surfaces can be mapped into disk by tat embedding and its variants. Although the distortion in tat embedding can be huge, it has theoretical guarantees to be inversion-free mapping onto convex planar domains. So starting with inversion-free initial map, like tat embedding, distortion solvers are designed both to minimize distortions and to prevent orientation flips. And there are many methods for keeping the initial orientation of simplicial map during the optimization, such as the design of distortion measures with special barrier property. I'll discuss it in next slides. Other methods for keeping positive orientation is line search filtering, and there are also methods for keeping global bijectivity, which I'll discuss later. Despite having theoretical guarantees, practically tat embedding has certain precision loss issues with floating point arithmetics, and on changing measures, it can fail to produce inversion-free map, even if the target domain is convex. Another common case in which it's not easy to compute inversion-free initialization is a constraint parameterization, with anchors fixed in the plane by given hard positional constraints. And of course, it's much more difficult to compute inversion-free initializations for volumetric problems. So in the view of those limitations, a number of methods were proposed for repairing an invalid initializations that contains inverted and collapsed elements. To explain briefly those methods, consider some basic deformation of a triangle grid with one flipped triangle marked in yellow. Methods for repairing invalid maps can be divided qualitatively into vertex-based method that modify vertex positions in order to fix inversions, and to simplex-based methods that first treat separately each simplex, for example, by cutting mesh into disconnected triangles. And then invalid simplices are fixed separately, and their vertices are stitched together by specifically designed matching constraints. Distortion optimization methods and methods for repairing invalid maps have been extensively studied by the computer graphics community. But still, due to the inherent differences, in most cases, the treatment remains separate. Nevertheless, both problems are crucial in fighting the high-quality mapping. Therefore, we propose a method called adaptive block coordinate descent, ABCD for short, aimed at solving in a single algorithm both the problem of fast distortion optimization and the problem of fixing invalid elements. Our algorithm is a vertex-based method that can be integrated with any first or second order solver, and is based on the two major ideas. The first idea is alternating optimization of newly proposed distortions that penalize invalid elements and offer standard distortion, modified in such a way that we both can fix existing invalid elements and prevent generation of new ones. And the second idea is adaptive partitioning of vertices into coordinate blocks according to the geometric configuration of the problem. So let's start with the first contribution of our method and explain how distortion are modified in ABCD. First, let's review the most common distortion measures employed in geometric optimization. Those are isometric, which are lengthwise, and conformal distortion, which are angle-wise measures, respectively. Those measures can be defined by different functions of singular values that penalize stretching and contraction for isometric distortions and non-uniform scaling for conformal distortion. Usually, if you collapse the target simplex, then those measures approach infinity because of a barrier term that explodes on degenerate elements. For example, consider the symmetric Dirichlet energy, d-iso, that measures isometric distortion. The barrier term of this energy prevents positively oriented elements from being collapsed. And this is a good property, but under invalid initializations, this property of the energy also prevents optimization from fixing the existing conversions. And that is bad. And therefore, we aim to modify existing energy in such a way that both tasks of fixing invalid simplices, that is inverted or collapsed, and preventing generation of new ones is possible within the same procedure. And we modify distortion energies according to geometric configurations of the mapping obtained in the previous iteration. Here denoted by SC, the orientation of simplex C at the previous iteration I, and assume the following deformation at iteration I plus one. We use previous orientation of simplices to modify the original measure D as follows. On valid simplices, D equals the original measure plus the barrier term in order to prevent new inversions, and we filter out the contribution of simplices that were previously inverted or collapsed. We denote by T tilde a distortion D modified according to those rules. With this modified distortion D tilde, invalid elements are no more blocked, and those can be fixed during the energy optimization. Moreover, after they are fixed, optimization will prevent the appearance of new inversions and new collapsed elements. And this approach enables an efficient alternating optimization of classical rotation invariant energies and of measures designed for repairing invalid simplices without badly interfering with each other. Next, we define the second class of the measures that penalize invalid elements. Assuming the positive orientation of the source elements, a simplex is inverted under F if it has a negative volume proportional to the product of its signed singular values. We penalize both the number of inverted elements and the negative product of the assigned singular values. And here, lambda is a uniform cost of a single invalid element. Negative gradients of this measure at flip move vertices of inverted simplices toward flipping from negative to positive orientation. And since orientation of a zero volume simplex is not well defined, we consider collapsed simplices as a separate class of illegally deformed elements that are penalized by following measure. A negative gradient of this measure move vertices of nearly collapsed elements toward unfolding those elements to a position with non-zero volume. And to simplify the task of repairing invalid elements, we combine those two measures into a single measure, into a single penalty of invalid elements. This measure penalizes both the inverted and collapsed elements. And clearly, this measure is SVD-based energy, and therefore it can be minimized along with usual rotation invariant distortions in an alternating pipeline. So we start with a fixer stage. It's a stage in which we optimize invalid penalty F to repair inversions and collapsed elements. After a certain number of iterations, we switch to minimization of a modified rotation invariant distortion D tilde. And when all elements are fixed, further processing is devoted solely to D tilde, which at that stage is just equal to the original energy D. And the process is terminated after convergence of all measures. Here, dashed lines depict the interval of line search that we have modified for our needs. And later, I'll explain about ABCD convergence criteria. And now let's talk about adaptive vertex partitioning. The vast majority of existing geometric solvers are global methods. Those methods update the entire set of target coordinates simultaneously. And most recent solvers are global methods, but among the few purely local methods are coordinate block descent strategies with constant small blocks. Block coordinate descent methods are easily parallelizable, but unlike in global methods, in block coordinate descent, it may take time for geometric information to propagate from one part of the shape to another. Our algorithm is a hybrid method based on adaptive block partitioning strategy that minimizes distortion separately over blocks of target vertices of varying sizes. So starting with invalid non-injective initial map, ABCD behaves as a modified block coordinate descent up to the point where the current mapping is cleared of invalid simplices, and then the algorithm converges rapidly into the chosen global solver. To understand our adaptive partition strategy, consider the following deformation of a planar bar into a spiral. With inverted triangles colored in yellow and areas of high isometric distortion D tilde colored in red. So if D tilde is minimized, then vertices sharing only inverted triangles are static vertices fixed in a place because by definition they have zero descent direction, while vertices of positively oriented elements are free to move at the current iteration. And geometric information from free vertices cannot propagate through static vertices. To illustrate it, consider a slight movement of some free vertex and observe how it impacts the trajectory of other free vertices. Geometric information from this vertex propagates and fills vertices that can impact each other, and the same process applied for remaining free vertices, it leads to the following natural selection of other vertex blocks. By the construction, the obtained blocks can be modified separately in the current iteration without interfering each other. Formerly, we defined a set of free edges that share free vertices and build the connectivity graph G of those edges and vertices. Then the coordinate blocks are the connected components of graph G. In this case, free vertices are partitioned into three blocks. We get the opposite configuration when we minimize invalid penalty F. Here, static vertices share only positively oriented elements, and vertices of inverted triangles are free to be modified. We use edges between those vertices to find three connected components. Each of those blocks is a flip segment of the spiral. And anchor points are, by definition, static vertices. They are fixed in a place. Therefore, anchor points can increase the number of blocks. For example, in this inversion-free spiral deformation, anchors depicted by blue points divide vertices into six blocks. The computational advantage of this algorithm is that by using graph coloring, we can optimize different blocks in parallel. Furthermore, we prove that for any solver, global solver S, ABCD iteration with S always attains a better result. I'll explain only the main idea. Assume that there is a three blocks, two blocks of free vertices, and one block of fixed vertices. First, we decompose energy according to the contributions of each block. And since ABCD minimizes each block separately, it will result in energy less or equal to that of the global solver. It follows just from the subadditivity of a minimum. And thus the claim is reduced to show that the descending direction of each vertex is the same in ABCD and in S. And it follows from the descending direction equation and from the construction of Hessian, along with our assumption on block partitioning. Because information does not propagate between blocks, Hessian can be rewritten in a block structure by reordering vertices, and it implies that the solution of the block system are the same in ABCD and S, and it proves the claim. And of course, it can be generalized straightforwardly for any number of blocks. Now we are in the position to present a full ABCD algorithm. First, we compute a global descent direction with respect to a given distortion measure. Then we use our adaptive partitioning for obtaining vertex coordinate blocks. Those blocks are optimized in parallel by using in each block a chosen solver and line search method. We start with the invalid element penalty and alternate between this measure and a modified rotation invariant measure d tilde, such as a conformal with a metric distortion. Our algorithm is very general and is compatible with most first and second order solvers. In following example, I'll use gradient descent and projective Newton solver for minimizing F and D tilde distortion respectively. In ABCD paper, we explain why we chose those geometric solvers. Also note that unless stated otherwise, D is assumed to be symmetric Dirichlet energy. And now the most interesting part of showing our results. Alternating optimization and adaptive block coordinate descent strategies are aimed at robust geometric optimizations. Therefore, ABCD can recover fast from highly distorted invalid initializations that contain thousands of collapsed and inverted elements, and it converges fast to low distortion mapping under hard positional constraints, like in this example of randomly initialized problem of a planar shape deformation. Other applications of ABCD include constraint parameterizations. In this example, we compute TAT embedding, and then we move eight target endpoints on octopus legs onto their prescribed positions in the plane. Like in this case, such initializations almost always result in collapsed and flipped simplices. And therefore, such problems with hard position constraints cannot be handled by most existing geometric solvers, However, those constraint parameterizations can be solved first by ABCD. Another example of constraint parameterization with ABCD. Here we place endpoints of a space fitting curve along corners of texture image. And by running ABCD, we are able to align precisely the texture image along these space fitting curve. Also using ABCD for unconstrained surface parameterization initialized by tight embedding is more reliable than using standard solvers. And this is because ABCD can repair invalid triangles that can be caused by certain numerical issues. Like in this example of a Hilbert curve with uneven triangulation. Tight embedding produces a number of inversions, and running algorithm fixes initial inversions, and it computes a metric parameterization. Also, our algorithm works in 3D, where it can recover from highly distorted initializations with many inverted tetrahedrons. We show some results of computing volumetric maps with ABCD. Here is a source mesh with anchor points marked in blue. And this is initializations with flipped tetrahedrons. We use two isometric energies in ABCD that we modify according to our algorithm. The first one is a symmetric Dirichlet energy, and the second one is as rigid as possible energy, ARAP, which is another proper measure of isometric distortion. And those are the results. More examples with constrained volumetric mappings. And here is a comparison of our algorithm with large bounded distortion method, which was previous state-of-the-art method in fixing inversions. We tested different parameters for LBD. In most cases, it did not fix all the inversions. It is only capable of bounding conformal distortion, while our method can minimize directly any SVD distortion energy. We also compared our algorithm with combinations of different existing methods for optimizing distortions and repairing inversions, both in 3D and in 2D, for surface parameterizations and for planar shape deformations. Also, we compared our method with recent embedding algorithms, and I ran thousands of automatic testings with randomized initializations to validate our algorithm. Finally, to summarize, we have demonstrated over a variety of geometric problems that ABCD exhibits superior robustness compared to existing methods, both in terms of the number of invariant simplices that it can fix, in terms of distortion levels, and also it is capable to deal with more complex positional constraints. In the second short chapter, I show how to overcome certain limitations related to positional constraints and to the differences between inversion-free and injective maps. Since we are using hard positional constraints, we cannot move badly placed anchors. For example, in inversion-free parameterizations, boundary curves of the rest and the target meshes need to be oriented consistently. Inconsistent placing of boundary anchors can result in undesirable results, as shown in the following example, where ABCD manages to compute inversion-free map, but the mapping is non-locally injective and it leads to texture artifacts. And of course, if all boundaries placed inconsistently in wrong orientation, then it will be impossible to compute positive oriented map at all. To resolve such failures, soft positional constraints should be used to penalize deviations from the prescribed positions. Also, these examples show another common limitation of inversion-free mapping algorithms. Inversion-free maps are not always bijective. For example, twisting triangle around the vertex can result in orientation-preserving map that is not locally injective. And therefore, common distortion solvers also can produce non-injective maps, both on the global and the local scales. Nevertheless, there is a theorem stating that if an inversion-free map is bijective on the mesh boundary, then it is global bijection. So that it's possible to impose additional constraints to prevent boundary overlaps and to guarantee global bijectivity. And there are several algorithms to impose injectivity constraints like scaffold meshes and boundary tracing methods. For example, the scaffold mesh method adds triangles around the mesh to get a simple non-overlapping boundary, so that inversion-free map of scaffold mesh induces a globally injective map of the original mesh. And here is a toy model example of combining our algorithm with the scaffold method. Another method to prevent boundary overlaps is tracing of boundary vertices. Usually the problem is initialized with injective map, so that the injectivity can be preserved if we prevent boundary self-intersections during the optimization. And this method was used previously in two dimensions for bijective unconstrained parameterization. And we have shown how to integrate our algorithm with the volumetric version of this method to prevent self-intersections and collapses of tetrahedral meshes. And we do it by traversing arrays along vertex trajectories through efficiently voxelized space to find boundary intersections. And the next chapter is about how to compute optimal number of coordinate blocks for more robust computations. Basically, we blend between purely local and global methods to attain vertex blocks of optimal sizes. And also this method addresses another important problem, when the optimization should be stopped to obtain an accurate solution without running redundant iterations. To get some motivation, consider the finest partitioning of this model into blocks of a single vertex, so that each vertex is optimized separately while its neighbors are fixed. And I'll call it a one-ring method. And consider this toy model with intentionally distorted initial map without inversions. And let's run a one-ring gradient descent. As you can see, despite a highly distorted initialization, it achieves a good local minima within a number of iterations. So you may think that if the basic one-ring gradient descent works in this example, then state-of-the-art solvers with much more accurate energy approximation should solve it easily. However, not only that, it takes much more iterations for state-of-the-art solvers, some of them immediately getting stuck. And how it happens? Basically, advanced solvers are designed to induce smooth deformations over an entire shape. And this works well in most cases, but not in all. Sometimes geometric noise appears in many real-world applications, for example, because of various numerical issues. And in such case, global approach is not efficient because vertices are not correlated and need to be modified independently. Moreover, under geometric noise, global Hessians can be very ill-conditioned, while in small blocks, numerical computations are much more stable. And in that case, the local approach should be used instead of the global. And of course, for smooth modifications, like in this example of bar to spiral deformation, a global method is a better choice. And also, there are mixed cases too, where hybrid methods like ABCD are the best option. And the aim of this chapter is to further improve ABCD. Consider noisy initialization with inversions. In this case, all non-inverted triangles are connected and put in a single block by ABCD. And the aim is to take the large blocks and to further partition them into smaller blocks to avoid the difficulties that I have illustrated in previous slides. So we propose to control block sizes with a threshold parameter. When it is large, we get large ABCD blocks, and lowering it induces the finest partitioning into one-ring blocks. So we get something in between the purely global and purely local partitioning that fits well with geometric configurations. Now denote this threshold parameter by K. Then blocks are constructed to satisfy this inequality of target coordinates x and descent directions d. It's similar to requiring d to be k Lifshitz continuous in each block. Reducing k speedups conversions in blocks because d becomes smooth, but it takes more time for information to propagate between blocks. So the goal is to find a best trade-off between the smoothness and the number of blocks. And we propose a procedure called local global blending for computing optimal threshold k as a function of its values from previous iterations and of the estimate r of how well those iterations performed with respect to each other. It starts from a given pair of values, and r measures performance ratio between iterations with high k and low k values, which I'll call for short just global and local iterations, respectively. So local global blending increases or decreases k in proportion to r, according to this equation. Without going into details, the idea here is to adjust parameters according to observed performance, and clearly estimates of performance are used to stop optimization if there is no progress. But as I'm going to show, those estimates are not enough accurate for local global blending. Now let's review existing performance estimates and let's show how to improve those estimates both for local global blending and for more reliable termination criteria. The basic termination criteria to estimate how close x is to a local minima is a gradient norm. But because each problem has its own range of values, gradient tolerance should be readjusted manually, even for the same problem in different resolutions. A more recent method computes the so-called characteristic gradient norm that estimates scales of gradients based on the problem geometry. And this termination criteria is consistent across different resolutions of the same problem. But still, it can be inconsistent when we switch from one type of problems to another. For example, consider these unconstrained spheral deformation, in which gradients are steadily decreased to zero. However, in a constrained problem with fixed endpoints, gradients around fixed points remain large because of the built tension around the endpoints. And as a result, the characteristic gradient criteria cannot fit to both problems. It either stops too early or too late. And also, gradients can be in a direction that does not reduce distortions at all. For example, if this model is rotated around its endpoint. So instead of the usual norm, we introduce the displacement norm that measures amount of non-rigid motion of vertices. A kernel of this norm is a space of rigid motions of a given mesh. Its basis elements include translation components and tangential components of rotations. And we add the displacement norm inequality to resolve failure cases of a characteristic gradient norm. And this is the first contribution to improve termination criteria. And the second contribution is to use it for local global blending, for estimating performances of local global iterations for the blending procedure. Here is an enhanced ABCD algorithm with additional local global stage for computing optimal parameter k for more rapid distortion optimization and better repairing of invariant simplices. And here are some results of enhanced ABCD algorithm with local global blending. It is compared against trivial alternation between local and global optimizations and against a standard ABCD algorithm. And also we compare it against a purely global version of adaptive blocker in undescent, and we compare it with previously available state-of-the-art methods combined in the alternating manner. Here you can see that ABCD with local global blending performs best. It is better than previous version of ABCD, and basically results are worsening as far as we deviate from ABCD and local global blending toward previously available methods. This chapter shows that by using capabilities of our algorithm, optimal mapping problems can be initialized with much better starting points than previously. In particular, our algorithm allows a multi-resolution approach to optimal mapping on meshes, and there were many multi-resolution schemes for vectorized data, like grid domains, and we show how to use it for non-regular mesh domains. And also, our algorithm can be combined with recent conformal flattenings to get much faster solutions of the parameterization problems. Usually, parameterizations are initialized by solving a linear system, where L is a discrete approximation of Laplacian. And the most popular method is stat embedding, and its variants based on the famous graph drawing method from 60s. So it's old method, but still it is widely employed because it is simple and has theoretical guarantees to be inversion-free map onto convex domains. However, these can cause many more additional iterations because often the initial convex shape is very far from the final shape of the UV map. And it therefore seems that mapping to other domains that match the structure of a source mesh should be a much better starting point for such algorithms like ABCD that can fix occasional inversions. However, direct TAT embedding onto complex shapes is not practical, since, as you can see here, it can invert and collapse too much triangles. A more recent methods can iteratively modify a linear system to decrease the total area of inverted triangles, but still the total number of invalid triangles can be large. So in the view of those limitations, we present two methods for better embedding of meshes into non-convex domains. The first one is called optimization embedding, and it is based on adaptive smoothing of a boundary around inverted triangles. Without going into details, I'll just tell that the aim of this method is to find a good intermediate position between the given shape and its convex approximation. And here it produces a small number of inversions that are easily handled by ABCD. And to obtain the boundary of the target shape, we parameterize a decimated mesh, and then we use the decimated parameterization and the optimization embedding to map original mesh into the obtained boundary. We also propose another method called deformation embedding, in which the decimated UV map is used as a shape deformation function to modify disk in the high resolution. As you can see, this initialization is very close to the expected shape of an optimized UV map, and it has low computational cost since it's just evaluation of a piecewise affine map on the vertices of the original model. And just to illustrate, assume that Y0 and X0 are TAT embeddings of decimated and of original meshes, and G is a mapping from Y0 to the final parameterization Y. And then original mesh is flattened first into X0, and then each point in X0 is mapped by G onto a more accurate shape X. And initializing ABCD with this scheme accelerates surface parameterizations. Here the example in which it takes only few ABCD iterations to fix inversions in deformation embedding, and then only a few iterations of ABCD isometric optimization to converge, while standard approach requires a much more costly projective Newton iterations. In this example, a multi-resolution approach is 3 times faster. Moreover, deformation embedding has certain theoretical guarantees. In particular, if the original mesh is just refinement of the decimated one, then deformation embedding preserves distortions obtained in lower resolution, and those transition to higher resolution cannot deteriorate the results. For example, a mesh can be refined by the linear subdivision scheme, and in such case, deformation embedding starts immediately from well-parameterized mesh. In more general mesh decimations and subdivision schemes, we can also use optimization embedding for the multi-resolution scheme. And of course, we can use more than two hierarchies to get a more smooth transition between different resolutions. And let's see some example of 3 hierarchies, starting with a standard method for the lowest resolution. And then we use it to initialize the middle resolution with optimization embedding. And then we switch to the original problem with the largest number of triangles. Comparing these parameterization with 3 hierarchies with the standard TAT initialization. Here, standard one runs much more time. Initializing tetrahedral meshes is much more difficult than triangle meshes because there is no good analogy of 3-dimensional TAT embedding to produce inversion-free maps, especially with positional constraints. And therefore, our multi-resolution approach is very useful for volumetric domains. In this example, we get rid of most flips in low resolution by running three-dimensional deformation embedding. And the starting point is very close to the optimized mesh. Volumetric maps of simple shapes like a bar can induce low distortion deformation of much more complex models that cannot be handled by other methods. For example, this bone-like material can be deformed into prescribed shape by optimal mapping of its bounding volume. And just to show effectiveness of our multi-resolution approach in three dimensions, here are two resolution hierarchies with deformation embedding. They produce initial map with a much lower distortion than running hundreds of iterations of the standard approach. And with multi-resolution approach, we get much better local minima. We propose another method for accelerating isometric parameterization by initializing ABCD with fast conformal mapping. There are many algorithms of fast conformal flattening based on linear methods, and it takes nearly the same time to compute that embedding or to compute those fast conformal mappings. But conformal maps such as boundary first flattening, BFF, introduced by Shahani and Crane, results in the shape that is much closer to the final isometric parameterization. In general, BFF can produce inversions, but usually it has only few invalid triangles, and therefore initializing ABCD with BFF can be much faster than the standard approach. And here's comparison of our parameterization method with the standard one. We tested our approach on the progressive parameterization dataset that contains tens of thousands of meshes in high resolution. In particular, we tested meshes on which BFF fails to construct inversion-free map and compared our conformal initialization approach with a standard isometric parameterization. And here is a summary of our results illustrated as a histogram of runtime ratios between the two methods. In what the vast majority of cases depicted by blue bins, ABCD with BFF initialization runs faster than projective Newton with stat embedding. Also note that running our parameterization method is much more reliable because on many collected meshes, that has a floating point precision issues and it fails to produce inversion-free maps. On those meshes, standard projective Newton doesn't converge at all. And therefore, we did not include those results into the histogram. But obviously, with those results included, our algorithm will look even better. And here are some examples when conformal initialization is a nearly optimized map and that has inversions. And here, on a high resolution Hilbert curve, our method is 20 folds faster. I'm going to skip some technical details on algorithms implementation. Just I need to tell that in this field, it's important to use correct tools to exploit best fast numerical methods and parallel computations. And the best way to understand algorithm details is to explore the provided implementation and play with this code. Here are results of combining all the introduced methods together, ABCD, local global blending, and acceleration techniques. And I think that the results are pretty impressive. For example, after only a few seconds on about 1 million triangles initialized with 20 flips, it obtains a parameterization visually undistinguishable from the final solution. That takes a little more time to converge, but still is very fast. And also note that those results were obtained on consumer level laptop. And I did a lot of tests to validate results in 2D and in 3D. Including a test of how changing various algorithm parameters affects those results. And here's a summary for three models that shows that algorithm behaves consistently over different configurations, both in fixing invalid simplices and in minimizing standard geometric distortions. And here an example shows that our initialization scheme has a negligible computational cost, even with relatively slow linear solvers such as Eigen. At the same time, it results in three times more rapid progress in high resolution. Finally, a few words on future applications. The first one is using our algorithm for volumetric shape matching. Despite abundance of surface matching algorithms, the problem of matching tetrahedral meshes is largely unexplored. And the main difficulty for extending surface matching to volumes was the computation of injective initializations under given boundary constraints. And I think that our algorithm is a natural candidate for resolving those issues. From a mathematical viewpoint, the problem can be formulated even beyond volumetric domains for n-dimensional simplicial complexes. And recently, it is gaining interest in computer graphics. For example, everyone is familiar with three-dimensional games and simulations, but how about going beyond three dimensions? And there is a recent SIGGRAPH paper that presents a game taking place not in 3D, but in four dimensions. You can follow the link and see how strange in four dimensions are even the most basic transformations. And I think it's a really exciting subject for future research. Thank you everyone for listening to my presentation.